Approximately 500 heads of state and dignitaries will be attending the Queen's funeral as official invited guests, although geopolitical tensions mean there are some noticeable absences. One News Europe correspondent, Mei Heron, is with us live from London now. Kia ora, Mei. Who hasn't been invited?
Good morning. Well, yes, the biggest name is obviously Russian President Vladimir Putin, but also the countries that are backing Russia, and that's obviously because of the Ukraine war, so countries like Belarus. But there's also countries that the UK isn't friends with because of what's happening in the home country, so Syria, Myanmar, those countries are also not invited. But like you say, geopolitics isn't that straightforward. So China is invited, despite the weird tension with the West, but their ambassadors have been banned from visiting Westminster Hall because of the country's treatment of Uyghur Muslims.
Maya, I'm hoping you can talk to us about some of the dissent we've seen over the last few days. We'll have a look at these pictures. This shows police on the right-hand side of your screen there cracking down on a protester in Scotland. How have protests surrounding the Queen's death been received?
Yes, yeah, so that beginning when that event happened in Scotland, police had quite a heavy-handed approach, didn't they? They were really rough with the person who heckled Prince Andrew. And over time, that seems to have waned a little bit. We had a bit of footage showing someone asking what would happen if they held up a sign saying, "Not my king." The officer said that he would be arrested. But then in Wales, it was a slightly different story. People got really up and personal with King Charles. Take a look at this.
We have to pay for your parade.
I don't believe that someone should be born into a position of power to rule over us.
So there were hundreds of people outside Cardiff Castle protesting against the king, and they were kind of allowed to coexist with the people who were there to support the king. So they seem to have found a slightly better balance as time goes on.
All right. Thank you so much, Mei. That is One News Europe correspondent Mei Heron, live for us in London. While most of the monarch's 15 realms have publicly expressed their intention to retain Charles as the head of state, or at least hold off on conversations about their constitutional future, some are moving more assertively towards republicanism. One News US correspondent Anna Burns-Francis has just returned to the US, and Anna, there have been some interesting reactions this week from some Caribbean nations.
There sure has been, Jack. Broadly speaking, in the Caribbean, you've got countries that have managed to gain independence but still retain the monarch as their head of state, if you call it. And then you've got these things called British Overseas Territories. Now, that's just a nice name for what we used to call colonies. But for countries like Antigua and Barbuda that have managed to gain their independence, it seems like a change of sovereign has not dissuaded them at all from pursuing this line of becoming a republic as soon as possible.
This is not an act of hostility or any difference between Antigua and Barbuda and the monarchy, but it is the final step, as I said before, to complete that circle of independence.
Now, we've seen tours of royal duty, as you might like to call them, from the fresh face of the family, William and Kate, going to places like Belize and Jamaica this year to try and shore up support, maybe try and punt off those decisions about gaining even more independence from the monarchy. But it doesn't look like it's going to work out for them. Even on that tour, there was the old shaking of Indigenous children's hands through wire fences. It just reeked of the colonialism that these countries are trying to get away from.
Yeah, that was very interesting. Just hearing there from Gaston Brown, the Prime Minister of Antigua and Barbuda. So clearly they're not too concerned about conversations around republicanism at this stage. But talk to us about the reaction to the Queen's death in Canada.
Well, Justin Trudeau has been very effusive. I think he called the Queen his favourite person in the world at the news of her death. But we haven't quite seen the same reaction from Quebec's leaders, the Bloc leader there saying the monarchy's involvement in Canada has been cruel and thorny. So that must have been some uncomfortable conversations there. But when you look at polling, actually, it doesn't look like Canada's going to move either way anytime soon. The Constitution causes a few problems with how they would manage stretching into any further independence or towards a republic anyway in the future. There was actually one really interesting discussion that came up this week, which was around their currency, the same debate we saw in New Zealand, as to whether they would change the monarch anytime soon. As someone pointed out, is now, in the time of discussions about equality, the time to be putting a 70-year-old white man back on the banknote.
All right, thanks very much for your time. That is Anna Burns-Francis, our One News US correspondent, live for us in New York. Australia's been more assertive than New Zealand in recent years in pushing the Republican debate. And One News Australia correspondent Andrew Macfarlane joins us now. How has that debate played out this week?
G'day, Jack. Well, the latest polling came out on Monday, so still pretty fresh, and it asked 1,000 Australians the question of whether they thought the monarchy was something they should be keeping here in Oz. And the numbers are in. It says 60% of all Australians thought the monarchy is the way to go, while 40% supported the idea of becoming a republic and electing a president. So really showing some pretty strong support there for the royal family still, although it does bear keeping in mind this is still really, really recent and the polling in the past has jumped up and down. It's no secret, though, it's been discussed in Australia, a referendum, but Anthony Albanese's come out this week basically saying his main commitment is this upcoming referendum on the Indigenous voice to Parliament. He wants to get that ticked off before he even thinks about going down this route. Here's what he told the ABC earlier this week.
Well, my views on that, of course, are well known and well documented, but now's not a time to talk about our system of government. Now is a time for us to pay tribute.
Yes, I suppose, Andrew, from a polling perspective, it'll be interesting to consider the numbers from this week with another poll in, say, 6 months or 12 months' time. How have Indigenous communities in Australia reacted to the Queen's death?
Yeah, Queen Elizabeth's reign represents around a third of colonial history here in Australia. So we've seen a wide range of responses from Indigenous and First Nations people here in Oz. You can see over my shoulder on the Harbour Bridge there, the Aboriginal flag was lowered to half-mast, which even in itself was somewhat controversial. So we've seen some people really rejecting this idea, saying really that the Crown and, yes, Queen Elizabeth's reign does represent some dehumanising of First Nations people here in Australia. But also we've seen a lot of commentary around people who have been able to separate the system, the monarchy itself, from the person and her life of service too. So a real range here in Australia, but a tricky debate which is still ongoing.
Andrew, you have also been looking at some of the reaction this week from South Asian countries. Tell us about that.
Yeah, in particular, it would be India and Pakistan, which has been really, really interesting. Obviously, there was the partition there in 1947, so a little bit before Queen Elizabeth's reign started. But that is such a piece of history over there, which is just so divisive and really, really broke up a lot of families and split up a lot of people. So we've seen a lot of people struggling too, I suppose, just like here in Australia, with that piece of history too. And when you compare, say, more Western countries, which have had a pretty large and significant outpouring of love, it's all over the TVs and things over here. It's somewhat different in both of those countries. I think the Guardian put it pretty well, saying it was a muted response at best. So I think, really, we've seen pretty broad range here and some countries really having to reckon with someone who I think can be recognised for their life of service, right, but also a piece of history which, let's be honest, hasn't been great for First Nations and Indigenous people across the globe.
All right. Thank you very much for your time, Andrew. That is One News Australia correspondent Andrew Macfarlane.